Yo, what is up guys? Coach Daniel here, aka Algo Daddy, aka Data Structures Poppy. And we're gonna dive into the sorting algorithm that you want to use to be able to crush technical interviews and land your dream job as a six-figure developer. Now, this is another tool for your tool set because as you go into these interviews, you wanna make sure you understand the fundamentals and the basics. This video is brought to you by Squarespace. Now, you don't have to know all of the sorting algorithms. You don't have to know all of the searching algorithms. You don't have to know all the data structures. You just have to know the foundations because everything else derives from that. I want to go deep into one of the sorting algorithms that is mostly known there. It's quite optimal and I'm in touch points on other sorting algorithms out there. But before we do that, make sure to hit that like button. Let's beat those YouTube algorithm gods. And then let's go ahead and subscribe and hit the bell notification icon. So whenever we drop these amazing videos that are going to help you crush your interview, you get notified right off the bat. So with that being said, guys, let's go ahead and dive into this video. So to give you guys some background, today we're going to be looking at sorting algorithms. So as I had mentioned before, this is just going to be different ways that you could sort specific data. For example, if I have an array full of integers and values and numbers and I want to sort it, what is the most optimal way that I can sort it? With the algorithm that you're going to learn today, this is one of the more popular ones, but there's also some that are just as fast, and I'll touch on those as well in this video. Let me give you a quick example of what a sorting algorithm might look like. Imagine that you have a line full of people and you're asked to sort these people so that the youngest person is in the front and the oldest person is all the way in the back. There's multiple ways that you can do this. You could basically ask, all right, guys, raise your hand if you're 1 year old, and then see who raised their hand. Raise your hand if you're 2 years old, raise your hand if you're 3 years old. Then someone raises their hand. You're like, all right, you're the youngest one, so go to the front of the line. And you could do that till everyone is in line from youngest to oldest. Of course, that's probably not gonna be the most optimal because you're gonna have to go through a lot of numbers to get everyone's age that is part of this line and then get them sorted and all of those things. So maybe another approach you could take to it is you can ask them to look at the person at the right and just ask them, hey, are you older or are you younger? Then if they're older, just tell them to swap places, and you tell them to do that a couple more times. Sooner or later, everything's going to be organized youngest to oldest. So these two are different approaches to sorting the line from youngest to oldest. In essence, these two are different algorithms. This video is brought to you by Squarespace. Now, Squarespace is an amazing platform because it allows you to build amazing websites without having to know everything about programming. Now, here's the best thing. As developers, I know you know that we care about analytics because we want to see how our customers are using our products to make sure that we can optimize it and tweak it for the best use. So Squarespace provides that with their built-in functionality. So their analytics tools even include things like page views, traffic sources, time on the site, most read content, and audience geography. With this breadth of knowledge, you're gonna be able to know everything about your demographic, about your audience visiting your website. And it gets even better because we know as well that it's all about going viral and sharing this with the world. So they have amazing social media platform sharing functionality. What that means is pretty simple. It has the ability to share on any social media platform that you can think about. So you could share your amazing websites and put it out there into the interwebs. And here's the best part yet. As a developer, something that you can do is you can start to build your own personal brand. And what that means is you're going to want to build an audience of people. Well, Squarespace has you covered because with Squarespace, you're going to be able to run email campaigns. When you're running these email campaigns and providing value to people, they're going to love you even more. They're going to want to be part of your journey and you're going to be able to grow the audience and just bring more value and impact into the world. So if you're looking to be a developer that is top-notch, a developer that is sought after by big tech companies, you're probably going to want to build an amazing email list with Squarespace's email campaigns, which will make it super easy to do. So go ahead, click the link below and check out Squarespace for a free trial when you're ready to launch your website. Go to squarespace.com/cleverprogrammer to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or a domain. So Squarespace is an amazing tool that you could use to build your own website or even your own portfolio to showcase to the world and build an amazing audience, build your personal brand, because as a developer, that'll be really useful. Now, the sorting algorithm might come in handy when it comes to technical interviews. And that's why I want to dive into it, because I want to talk about the ones that are going to be most optimal. So what do I mean when I say most optimal? Let's go ahead and dive into the big old time complexity time chart. So I've talked about big old notation before. If you haven't watched that video, make sure to go check out that video, because I'll go deep into this. Depending on your sorting algorithm, if it's something similar to the one where I mentioned where you talk to the person to the right and then switch with them and you keep on doing that till everyone is in their position, it's going to be something along the lines more of something what's called like the bubble sort, right? And that has a pretty bad time complexity, with worst case scenario being big O of N squared, right? This chart is even labeled with red being horrible, orange being bad, and yellow being fair. But of course, it's going to depend, because for sorting, there's a lot of things that have to happen. So it's not like we can come up with a super optimized sorting algorithm that is going to be in constant time or log N time. So something we want to shoot for with sorting algorithm is actually be along the big O of N log N time. And what sorting algorithm is this? Well, there's a couple, but the one I want to talk about today is called merge sort. So I want to pull up a quick article by Geeks for Geeks, because they have a nice visual of how merge sort works. If you go to this site, you're going to see they'll give you more details on what is happening, but this is the essential breakdown. Imagine you have your array of unsorted numbers. All you're going to do, very similar to the binary search that we talked about before, which is a very optimal way of getting through things, is you're going to cut it in half into two different arrays, right? Right down the middle. Of course, if it's uneven, one array is going to have one more element than the other. And you're going to keep on doing that until you have a sorted array. But let me ask you this. How do we know when we have a sorted array? Well, if you have an array of size 1, doesn't matter what value you have in it, that is a sorted array, because there's no other way they can sort it so that it's ascending to descending, because it just has one element. So what that means is we are going to keep on cutting the array in half and creating a new array until each and every single element inside the array has its own array. It's encapsulated by its own array. Now that we know that that is the most smallest element and it's already sorted, we could start to put things together. So we can start to bring these elements back together. For example, here we have the array that had the value 38 and 27. When we separated them, we saw that we had 38, which is one array that's a sorted array. And then we have 27, which is another array, which is also a sorted array. When we put them together, we just merge them into an array that is sorted. So it could be a simple algorithm, like going to the leftmost, in this case, it's just one because we know it's sorted, and then just picking the lowest and then putting it into the new array, which is this one right here. When we do the exact same thing with 27, 38, 3, and 43, what that looks like is we see, all right, 3 is the smallest one, let's put it into the new array. 27 is the smallest one, let's put it into the new array. 38 is the smallest one, let's put it into it. So it's just checking the leftmost element that hasn't been taken off yet. And you're able to build the array back up. So it's really interesting, because the idea is you break the array in half really quick until you get to the most sorted array, which is going to be one index, and then you start to merge everything back together. So you're probably thinking, all right, that's great, makes sense, but how does this actually work in code? I'm glad you asked. So here I got a quick algorithm from Stack Abuse. You could go check them out. It's a very simple algorithm that shows how this is going to work. So first, we have to build out what's called the merge function, or the merge functionality. Like how I was saying that at some point, we have to start to merge all these arrays back together to create this big array. We need to have that functionality. So let's go ahead and dive deep to see what that functionality is going to look like. So first things first, since we're going to be merging, two arrays. We have a left array and a right array. And what that's going to look like is we might have array 1, which has 2 elements. That's a left array. And then we have array 2, which might also have 2 or 3 elements, depending on the sizing when we're first merging them together. We're going to stay in a while loop as long as one of these arrays still has values that we need to iterate. In this case, we need to iterate through all of these values. We need to add it into the new array, because we know the new array is going to be of size 4, since there's 4 different elements, right? So all we're going to do is we're going to compare the very first index of that array, because again, we already know these arrays are sorted because they started from just single index. when they got merged, they created a newly sorted array, which then created a newly sorted array. So as they're getting back merged together, they're going to be sorted. So, and they're going to be merged into this bigger array that's going to be of size 4. So if the one on the left array is less than the one on the right array, we're going to get this value and put it in here. And then in JavaScript, we're going to do a left.shift, which would mean this becomes the new zero index. So it's kind of like if we just disregarded that and that doesn't exist anymore. If the right is less than the left, then we would move that one to the next index that we are on. And we're gonna keep on doing that till the very end. And we're gonna keep on doing that till one of these arrays runs out of values. So finally, what are we gonna return? We're going to return the array we just created, which is this very first part. We're going to append the left array, and then we're going to append the right array. Now this order doesn't really matter because in reality, one of those arrays is gonna run out before the other one. So when we concatenate it, if it's just an empty one, it's not gonna add anything. So assuming that the left one ran out of values first, we're gonna concatenate the left to the newly array. That's not gonna add anything, but then we concatenate the right array. It's gonna append the rest of the variables to the end. So that is going to give us the sorted array. This is the merge function, because it's merging two arrays and giving you a sorted array. So, and just to recap, all concatenate means is you're just gonna put it or append it to the back of that array. For example, if I have this array with the values of 1 and 2, and I have another array with the values of 2 and 3, and I want to concatenate this array to the end, what happens is now I'm gonna have an array of size 4, and I'm gonna have 1, 2, which is this original array, and I'm gonna have 2, 3, which is that one. And it's like merging these. So once you have your merge functionality, which is going to take care of everything under after it's been sorted, we need to be able to get to this point. We need to be able to break down our arrays so that we can get them to size 1, because that means they'll be automatically sorted. Then we could call the merge function until everything is merged and we have one array that has everything sorted. So this is going to be the merge sort function. This is going to be the actual function that is going to produce the whole merge sort that we talked about. This is going to be the search algorithm in here. So because the first thing we want to do is we want to start to divide things in half, because we've talked about how optimal that really is. We're going to find where the halfway point is of this merge array. If you haven't seen recursion, this is going to be an intro to that, because it's going to be very crucial when it comes to merge sort. What we're going to notice is we want to see the length of this array, because we mentioned before, if the array is of size 1, it's automatically sorted. If the array is of size 0, meaning it doesn't exist, it's already sorted. We could start to concatenate all those together. So this is what's called the base case, or the terminating case, because we're gonna keep on calling the merge sort until the array is of size 1. It's like, all right, cool. Now we can actually start to bring everything together. So this in recursion is what's the base case. Whenever we see that the array is of size 1, then we're gonna start returning that, and it's gonna ripple everything up to the first function that called it. Now, if it's not of size 1, what we're going to do is we have to split up the array. So this is exactly what it looks like. In JavaScript, you would call a function called array splice, which would go from 0 to half. Half was the number that you calculated of the halfway point in between the array. You're going to assign this to a variable that's going to be left. So this is going to represent the left side of your array. And now, because you took off that with the splice, the array variable has the right side of your array. So what does that look like? When you have your array of size 4 and you call the splice from 0 to half, let's just say it's gonna be 2 in this case, what happens is the left variable, or this variable right here, is going to get the left side of the splice, everything from 0 to 2. And then the original array is going to keep the assignment of what wasn't spliced, because the splice is like taking it off. So now the left variable contains your left array and the array contains your right array. So what we're going to do is we're going to call the merge function, which is going to merge the two different arrays in a sorted manner. And what that looks like is we're going to call the merge function, but it's going to recursively call the merge sort. So this is what ends up happening. If you're not familiar with recursion, this might be a little bit weird, but let me tell you about recursion. Recursion is when you have a function calling itself. So what has to happen first is we need to merge sort the left array again. So if the left array is of size 2, the merge sort hasn't stopped because it needs to get to a size 1. So it's going to get split up again into a left and a right. It's going to get split up again to a left and a right, split up again until it's a size 1. When it's a size 1, it'll return both of them and merge them together. That's when it's going to call the merge functionality. So I don't want to dive too deep into recursion. We'll make another video on that, but this is how merge sort works. And this is a very optimal way to be able to sort things. There's other things such as heap sort, quick sort, depending on the structures and things like that. Sometimes, for example, JavaScript might use under the hood quick sort or different other sorts there. So what I did here is I quickly created an array of size 20 with any value from 0 to 100, and they're just random values. I printed out the array, and you can see here it's 66, 81, 99, so on and so forth. And I just ran the merge sort array, and it's able to sort everything properly like how it needs to. So guys, like I mentioned before, this is something else that you could be armed and equipped with. You don't have to go out there and learn all of these sorting algorithms. You just have to know the ones that are most commonly used, the ones that are the most effective. So if you look at the time complexity of this one, you're gonna see it's big O of N log N. It's also the same for quick sort, but then some of these have some pros and cons. For example, although the time complexity for merge sort might be constant, the space complexity is going to be different because you have to create so many arrays just to get this to work. With quicksort, you're not going to get crazy space complexity, but the worst case scenario might end up being big O of N squared. So understanding merge sort, understanding quicksort, or some of these would be good enough because in reality, you're not going to be asked to use bubble sort because it's not as effective. So with that being said, guys, now you guys know some of the things are going to be foundational when it comes to algorithms. Just make sure you know one of the more effective sorting algorithms. When it comes to searching, make sure you understand binary search, and probably that's the most effective search algorithm. What I want to jump into next is I want to start to dive into data structures with you guys, because I want to show you guys how certain data structures might be used for specific situations and what's the best way they can go about that. So when you're asked to solve a coding problem, you'll be able to crush it. Now, if you're not being asked to solve the coding problem because you're not getting on interviews, well, today's your lucky day. We have a special training for you. I want you to click the link below. This is gonna be a special training so that you can become a better JavaScript developer. You're gonna learn everything about front-end and build amazing applications. You're gonna be able to build an amazing portfolio that is gonna get you those interviews. So once you show up to the interviews, you use what you learned in this video and you absolutely ace those interviews, you crush it, they give you an amazing offer, you ask for a raise, they give you that raise because you're like, oh my God, this guy's amazing, we need to have him in our company. So with that being said, guys, go ahead, smash that like button, hit that subscribe, hit that bell notification icon so that you can be notified the minute we drop more videos just like this one. And if you don't, then the algorithm gods are gonna look down on you. All right, guys, with that being said, Coach Daniel here signing out, AKA Data Structures Poppy, AKA I'll Go Daddy. I'll see you in the next one. Peace.